in that tempo to put points on the board against, I think, a stout defense for the Wolverines.
Michigan won the toss and deferred. So Oregon State will receive the opening kickoff from Kenny Allen. And the home opener for Michigan underway, hosting the Beavers from the Pac-12, Ramel Dockery. Out to the 22. And here come the Beavers on offense, led by a true freshman, Seth Collins. He's from San Diego. 6'3", 195 pounds. He arrived in January in time to be involved in spring practice out of Granite Hills High School. Not particularly highly recruited. He was going to San Jose State before Gary Anderson's staff offered him the scholarship. And he had a nice debut against Weber State. Ran for 152 yards. That's his primary weapon. Flips it to Victor Bolden. He's to the 24-yard line. The original line of scrimmage, the 21. A gain of 3 for the Beavers.
Well, one thing you want to look for Michigan's defense, will they play with great effort? Last week, they didn't play with great effort, and that could have been because of the up-tempo that Utah brought. But that's one thing I'm keeping my eye on. Are they going to have 11 hats on the football?
Collins out of the gun now. Hands it off to Chris Brown. Nice hole, and he's into the clear. The safety comes over to chop him down and prevent a touchdown. Delano Hill and Jabril Peppers prevented a score on the second play from scrimmage. It's a 26-yard gain.
Well, it's all about vision right here. See the patience in the cutback to the open hole. You get a great clear out block by number 56, Isaac Seamalu, the best offensive lineman on the Beavers.
They come quickly to the line of scrimmage. Play fake by Collins. Hit as he throws. Had a man open, and it's over the head of Bolden. And the contact threw off the pass. Here are today's impact players. Some of them. Just about everybody has a chance to impact the game one way or the other.
Well, you saw Chris Brown, what he can do. Big 6'5" wide receiver Jordan Villeman. Willie Henry and Jabril Peppers. Both of them stout athletes. Probably the most explosive players on the Wolverines defense.
Collins gave it to Bolden. He turns the corner and gets banged out of bounds inside the 35 by Jared Wilson, the safety. 21-yard gain. They'll mark it at the 30-yard line. An impressive opening drive for the Beavers.
Well, Caleb Smith, number 10, the tight end, does a good job of getting a block along with Chris Brown. Michigan has to get off blocks. They're getting held one-on-one. They're not defeating their play. You see what he can do with the football, Victor Bolden.
Collins under duress. High throw and a terrific catch. There's Jordan Villeman at the 18-yard line. Gain of 12. First down, Oregon State.
Just big play after big play. Throwing the ball on first down, which can set things up, and it helps to be 6'5", as he cuts off Channing Stribling, number 8 for the Wolverines, to bring the catch in.
There was a flag down. It looked like Michigan was offside. They'll turn down the penalty.
First down.
John O'Neill leading a Big Ten officiating crew in this non-conference game. One of the questions for Oregon State, would Collins be poised in his first road game in front of more than 100,000? He's wrestled down for about a 3-yard loss by Chris Wormley.
He's continuing his tear from last week. 3 tackles for loss against Utah. Gets a TFL right there. Explosive, 300 pounds, Sean. He looks like a big tight end. He's not a heavy 300 pounds. He's a slim 300 pounds. Good athlete.
Good student as well, academic all Big Ten last season. Loss of 3. Collins, lots of time. Man breaking free. It is caught. No signal. Now it is a touchdown for Hunter Jarman as he got behind Jordan Lewis.
What a touch by the freshman Collins, thrown to that back pylon. Right foot down, no question on a touchdown.
Yep. I guess the question is, did he possess it? And it looks like he did.
No problem there.
replay is not going to stop it. So it's a touchdown, 21 yards. Problem on the hold. Kick is up and good from Garrett Owens. Nick Perepski, who's the punter, managed to get the hold down. They go 79 yards in seven plays. Took less than 2 minutes to do it. Well, the blimp has arrived from game day, not far up the road in East Lansing, where Michigan State hosts Oregon tonight on ABC. The day starts with Oregon State at Michigan and a very impressive opening drive by the Beavers, engineered by Seth Collins. Hunter Jarman, the touchdown reception. And a lot of the air has gone out of this crowd very quickly. Jubilant with the home debut of Jim Harbaugh. Garrett Owens kicks off, and a hook out of bounds. A great field position to start the day for Michigan's offense. And Gary Anderson shaking his head in disbelief. He has a good kicker who didn't execute there. The ball comes out to the 35. That's where they'll start under Jake Rudock, the transfer from Iowa. He's from South Florida. Two-year starter at Iowa with the two touchdown passes at Utah, now 36 for his career, two of them as a Wolverine. He had three interceptions in that game, including a pick six that turned a seven-point deficit into a 14-point disadvantage for Michigan. As Todd said, Jim Harbaugh concurred. They thought two of those interceptions were on the receivers for running poor routes. Rudock looks like he wants to go deep, and he is going deep, and it is incomplete, intended for Amara Darboe, and broken up by Treston DeCoux.
I like the call to get back in it. They had some open receivers last week, and they had a problem with timing. That time it was pretty good timing, but you see DeCoux back there playing the football, avoiding the pass interference, but it's an aggressive call.
Crowd thought there should have been pass interference, and it did appear that DeCoud's arm made contact with the shoulder of the receiver a little bit before the ball arrived.
Just in time.
Spoken like a true defensive player. Davion Smith, the ball carrier. Joshua James made the tackle. In a 3-4 defense for Oregon State, both teams in the coaching change have gone to 3-4 looks as their primary defense this year. Michigan gets up quickly. They spread the field. Two receivers wide each side, butt to the right, and Rudock buried and then lost the football, and the Beavers have it. Romo Mangiello delivered the hit and recovered the fumble. And so far, Harbaugh's home debut is a big dud for Michigan.
Well, problems on the offensive line. Mangiello, how right here, number eight, is going to come on the blitz. Watch. He's going to come untouched. First of all, there's nobody there to protect him. Now, if you don't have enough guys to block, that's a hot read by Jake Rudock. He has to throw hot to a wide receiver, and you're still seeing a young offense, not by age, but by what they know and how they adjust to blitzes, make mental mistakes, which cost them.
Only two starters back from a year ago for the Oregon State defense, but they make a big play. Here's Bolden, who can throw it. It's a throwback to Collins and behind him. Bolden was under duress. I spoke with Dave Baldwin, the offensive coordinator, last night. He was talking about the many things Bolden can do. He said he can also throw the ball. I'm not saying that you're going to see that, but with the little gleam in his eye, we had a feeling we would see Bolden throw the ball today, and it didn't take long.
Yeah, I think the right time to make that call after big turnover, aggressive defense. We could see Bolden in the backfield too, Sean, as a running back, like right now.
Mm-hmm. They want to give him more touches. He wasn't as involved against Weber State as they like. He fumbles the football, and it's caught out of the air by Joe Bolden. And a late flag thrown where the tackle was made. Bolden, the defensive captain, with a huge play. Michigan takes over at its own 38-yard line.
Sideline warning. Michigan, they're first.
So when you have a running back that's not used to running the ball inside, he usually runs the ball outside, you understand you're going to get hit from all different angles. He does not do a good job of securing the football, and bam, right there, it's knocked out by Taco Charlton.
The fact that's a direct reflection of the fact that they weren't able to get him the ball in the passing game last week. So productive the last couple of seasons, they wanted to get him the football. He's got to protect the ball, as Chris said, when he's getting in traffic.
Yeah, he's got to run outside, not run inside.
Well, each team has turned it over. It's swung out wide. Rudock to Amara Darbaugh, and a big gainer to the Oregon State 41-yard line. He had a big opener, 8 catches for 101 yards and a touchdown at Utah. This play good for 22.
Yeah, and right here, J.U. Chesson helps spring it as he gets Decoud on the ground for lead block. And Decoud's got to force that ball back inside. You have an edge player, you got to turn it back to your pursuit, which he did not, which was the reason for the big game.
Now the eye, Joe Carriage, the offensive captain of this team, is the fullback, former walk-on, leading the way for Davion Smith. Caleb Salvo really couldn't plant him. Looked like he was about to lift him up and drop him. But Smith battled forward to the 35 for a gain of 6.
Well, pad level is what Michigan's offensive line needs to do to move people. Right there, you saw a hole where Smith didn't have to not stop his momentum. He can hit it on the go and north and south, and he's an effective running back when he can do that.
Michigan had only 76 yards rushing, averaged 2.6 per rush at Utah, but they thought they were close. The backs missed some holes. Sometimes they were one block away from a much bigger gain. And Smith called himself out for missing several open holes. Took that one to the 32. Third down and a yard, 4 minutes in. Oregon State leading Michigan 7-0.
I think you can be a little bit optimistic about the running game because Smith is not getting touched until he's 1 or 2 yards past the line of scrimmage. That tells me the offensive lineman is moving that defensive line of the Beavers back.
Rudock, a play fake, stumbled as he faked. Dropped it in the flat for a first down. First catch of the day for Jake Butt. Tackled by Cyril Nolan Lewis.
And this is Michigan football. This is why Jim Harbaugh's here. This is exactly what they want to do. There's a temptation when you have the wind gusting in your favor to try to take some shots. I know Coach Harbaugh wanted to get some big plays early on that first drive. It didn't work. Drive two, they're back to what they want to do. 22 personnel, 2 backs, 2 tight ends, pounding away. Third down and 1, play action, of course, to the tight end.
And that can wear on a defense as the game progresses. If you're successful running the football, they'll start to wear down on that front 7.
Now a pistol look. Ty Isaac has committed running back, but flags before the snap.
Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Graham Glasgow, the center, 5th-year senior. It's a veteran offensive line. They have 4 starters back, and Eric Magnuson, who's a new starter at right tackle, started some last year. Combined, they have 87 career starts.
Coaches praised Rascal's work last week, the highest grading offensive lineman against Utah.
Very smart, 2-time academic all-conference. Makes a lot of the calls up front. Rudock throws short, and the gain goes to the 28-yard line for Drake Harris. First catch of the season for the sophomore from Grand Rapids.
I'll tell you one thing that will drive a coach crazy. When a receiver falls down to catch a ball, when he doesn't have to fall down to catch a ball, because then you start eliminating your opportunity for yards after catch. He did not have to fall after that one.
Possibility for yak when the coaches watch the film.
Yes, sir.
Second and 12. First career catch for Drake Harris, who didn't see any action last year as a freshman. Davion Smith back in. He lowers his shoulder and powers down to the 22-yard line, and a big third down upcoming for the Wolverines. They'll need 6 to move the chains.
Well, you're 3rd and short, and the one guy, so you're 3rd and 5, the one guy you have to take out if you're Oregon State is Jake Butt. That's the go-to guy on the money downs. One way to do that is you jam him at the line of scrimmage and don't give him a free release, because he'll kill you if you do.
Most catches in a game by a Michigan tight end in 20 years is 8 against Utah. As Jay Reimers played in the NFL. Rudock throws, incomplete. Off the hands of Grant Perry, the true freshman. Caught three balls in his debut at Utah and was a spirited blocker. He was also the guy who ran the wrong way a couple of times, leading to Rudock interceptions. So the drive stalls for Michigan, and the question mark to start the year is the kicking game. Kenny Allen was 1 for 2, made a 29-yarder, missed from 44 in the loss at Utah. This will be a 40-yard try from the left hash mark. Blake O'Neill, the punter, is the holder, and that one is good. So the first home points of the Jim Harbaugh era off the foot of Kenny Allen. It's 7-3.
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Buick, proud partner of the NCAA. Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and College Football. It's a one-of-a-kind tradition. And Cialis.
Aerial coverage of today's game provided by Goodyear. Everything Goodyear has learned making tires that go the distance inspires what they roll into yours. Goodyear, more driven. The blimp can move. Made a very quick transition from East Lansing, the venue from which game day originated this morning, to here in Ann Arbor. I would guess going back to East Lansing tonight, they have enough gas in the blimp.
It'd be versatile.
Kenny Allen kicks off, as Todd said, a pretty stiff wind at his back. And a touchback. Well, as the blimp flies the distance from the Big House Michigan Stadium up to Spartan Stadium in East Lansing, you want to guess, Chris?
49 miles.
Good, nice job. A little longer drive, a little over 60 miles as you navigate the roads. You're going to make the trip up there tonight, yeah, be in attendance for the Ducks and the Spartans.
And I think the Ducks need to tighten up that defense, Sean. 42 points and over 500 yards given up against Eastern Washington last week. It'll be interesting to watch how that plays out.
Seth Collins takes the direct snap. Chris Brown knocked down for no gain. That Oregon-Michigan State matchups tonight on ABC. Both teams with hopes of being in the college football playoff at the end of the year. The first head-to-head top 10 matchup of this college football season. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. ABC Saturday Night Football presented by Wells Fargo. Brown got outside. Got chopped down by Jordan Lewis. He'll be marked down at the 28-yard line. And it is 3rd down and 7.
You got to be aware of the quarterback scramble. When you take a look at Seth Collins and you break him down, he's a one-read-and-go guy. You don't give him too much to think about. He'll turn a throwing lane into a running lane into a heartbeat.
Victor Bolden lines up in the backfield again. His fumble on the last drive cost them points. And Collins very close to the first down. Desmond Morgan belted him. They're going to mark him just short of the line to make. About a foot short, and Gary Anderson has a decision to make. And he's going to send the punting team on.
Well, I was tempted to go for it. I really are. I mean, you're in the Big House, and I understand the decision, but it wouldn't be out of the realm of possibility or crazy if he did choose to go.
He had a fake in the arsenal. Wouldn't be a bad time. As we noted, they're punting into a pretty good wind. It probably won't change field position that much. Nick Perebski's the punter. Sophomore from Melbourne, Australia. And they came after him and got close. And again, the wind knocks it down. A good field position for the Wolverines. They'll mark it at the 32-yard line, 34-yard punt. The offense huddles around Jim Harbaugh. Tim Drebno's the offensive coordinator, calls the plays with considerable help from Coach Harbaugh. Jim said he knew since he was a very young boy coming to this piece of ground with his dad, Jack, longtime assistant coach of Michigan, that he wanted to be a coach.
He's a good one.
In the flat, Rudock in a good tackle. Joe Carriage could not get away. Caleb Solo, the linebacker in their 3-4 alignment, junior from Kent, Washington, made the tackle.
And, Sean, I love the fact that they're throwing the ball on the first down. I mean, everything is so important in this offense is geared around running the football. Well, one way to open up some lanes is to have teams think about the ball being put in the air on first downs. So far, he's done that the past two series.
Henry Pogge comes in at fullback. They do have a number of fullback types and tight ends, and they'll use a lot of them. Rudock got away from the blitz. A little pump fake to get the first down. There is a flag down back at the 33-yard line. And this one's coming back.
Number 8, Mungiao, got held trying to come off and make a play on Rudock.
Harvey, offense number 19. 10 yards from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
Henry Pogge, who just came in at fullback, guilty of the hold.
Always a safe play here for an offense, second and long. And as a defense, you run a defense that's geared to stop a quick screen or a draw.
Second and 17. Four-man rush. Here is the screen. Davion Smith couldn't get away. Joshua James, the initial contact.
Yeah, Michigan's the more experienced team here. Oregon State, a lot of freshmen and sophomores playing. The Wolverines, a lot of juniors and seniors. Penalties, something you've got to monitor in this game. They can't make the young inexperienced mistakes. When we talked to Coach Harbaugh yesterday, he said specifically the holding penalties. They had 5 holding penalties for their offensive line last week. It's something to monitor.
Well, those are killer. I mean, especially after getting a positive game. And the momentum that it takes away, Todd, is just amazing, especially for a team that struggles with confidence.
Ben Braden, the left guard, the injured player, returning starter from a year ago. He's replaced by David Dawson. Third down and 13. This is certainly an area where Michigan can improve over a year ago. The last season under Brady Hoke and his staff, there's Dawson, the new guard. Michigan last year, 31.7% on third down. That was 118th in the country. 6 of 16 at Utah last week. Rudock chased from the pocket, throws a duck. Looked like he was very close to the line of scrimmage when he threw. It's an incomplete pass intended for J.U. Chesson. Levante Barnett was putting the heat on Jake Rudock.
Well, if you can't create separation by receivers, there's no place to throw. The protection's outstanding, but he can't run for 15 yards on the first down, so you have to count on your receivers to create some type of separation, and they're not doing it.
Blake O'Neal to punt. Ramel Dockery standing at his own 25-yard line. O'Neal, an Australian as well. Both of these teams have punters from Australia. More and more kickers and punters from Australia coming to this country. Fair catch made by Dockery on a 49-yard punt. Great way to watch the U.S. Open tennis. Stream every match live at home or on the go. Download the Watch ESPN app or visit WatchESPN.com. So you can watch football and tennis at the same time. Women's final today at 3 Eastern time. Surprising final matchup. Chris Brown, the ball carrier. On first down for Oregon State, first play of this possession goes for a couple. James Ross and Maurice Hurst made the tackle.
Good young players, and the one thing Michigan does have this year is depth on that defensive line. I would say that's the strength of the defense, but also the strength of the whole football team.
In the conscious effort to get Victor Bolden more involved in the offense this week, he's lined up in the backfield again and now goes in motion. Seth Collins looked in his direction, threw deeper, and a diving catch made by Jordan Villeman for a first down to the 33-yard line.
Offensive coordinator Dave Baldwin right here. They're going to get that matchup. They'll line up three receivers to one side. Billiman, because he's 6'5", on the other. And they like the one-on-one matchup that can present.
Dave Baldwin's been around 10 major college football programs. He was the head coach at San Jose State. Collins dropped for a loss. Another tackle for a loss by Chris Wormley.
You know, he's tackled short there, but been really impressed with Collins today and just how relaxed he is at the quarterback position. We interviewed him yesterday. He's a young quarterback. He's new to the program. He just seems like there's a lot going on. There's so much to take in when you're first with a program like this. But today he's looked relaxed at quarterback. His footwork is good. He's going through progressions. Really good start for number four.
Great ball fake, and Collins takes off running and is tackled from behind by Joe Bolden. The linebacker ran him down just shy of midfield.
Well, part of this offense is making a good read. Take a look. He's looking at the defensive end. He sees Ojemudia jump down inside, and all he sees is green, and he's such a tremendous athlete. Actually, a good tackle in the open field by Bolden and Jared Wilson, because he's fast enough to take that to house.
They felt Collins kept the ball too often last week. In the zone replay, he throws a deep ball, a little bit of a wobbler, and Villeman with a flag down. Contact at the end of the play. Jabril Peppers had the primary coverage.
Pass interference, defense number five. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Well, the best athlete on his team is that guy, number five, Jabril Peppers. And I think he's in pretty good position. Now, watch his hands. He's going to start hand slapping right here. And he runs in and makes contact with the forearm before the ball's there. And it's a call. I mean, you got to play that a little bit. If you're going to let him play, you're going to let him play. Now, he's got to loosen his coverage as the game goes on, Sean, because he knows that they're going to call it tight.
Timeout called by Oregon State just as the Beavers were about to snap the ball. They have been impressive on offense here in the first quarter, leading 7-3. Let's send you back to Cassidy in the studio.
Thanks, Sean. Let's check out this Buffalo Wild Wings wild play. Bowling Green, Maryland, Will Likely, standout cornerback, punt return specialist, showing off what he does best. 85 yards, punt return for 6 to end the first quarter. Maryland up 10-0 to start second.
All right, Cassidy, thank you. Oregon State leading 7-3. Seth Collins, Todd made the point when we visited with him last night at their hotel, he was antsy, jittery. And I thought, wow, if he's nervous talking to Todd McShay, what's he going to be like tomorrow in front of 110,000 people? But he has been rock solid to this point. Handed it off to Chris Brown, who got stood up by Desmond Morgan with 10 tackles last week at Utah. And Chris, Gary Anderson said about Seth Collins, he's one of those guys who seems to be better in the games than he is at practice, more poised in the game. They were really impressed by his demeanor last week in his first ever college game.
Impressed and surprised, because Gary doesn't know how he's going to react today, but I mean, he's as good as advertised. It doesn't matter if they're playing Weber State or Michigan on the road. He looks like the same guy to me.
4 for 5 passing. Deltron Sands, the new running back, he gets his first carry of the day. Got inside the 35 before he was launched back by Joe Bolden, who's off to a terrific start, the senior from Cincinnati.
Colerain High School, prominent power in Ohio. Now, if you got Billman lined up to the trip side and he's by himself, if you're Michigan, you've got to be able to double or take that away. He's going to down here, and we'll see if they'll go into a motion right here. But that's Villeman right there that's kind of been their target.
Could be 4-down territory into the wind with under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. Michigan brings a blitz. Collins stepped up into it and threw a duck. And at Oregon State, they don't like ducks. It was over the head of Victor Bolden.
No, they don't. And it looked like Seth should have ducked right there. Now, that's a decision. I think it's a poor decision, and here's why. He's so effective with his legs, Sean. He dropped his eyes. When he dropped his eyes, he lost the wide receiver. Once his eyes drop, he's got to tuck that ball and go.
And they will go for it on fourth down. Fourth and seven. They need to reach the 27-yard line. Chris Brown, the running back. They're setting up a screen. Villeman gets tackled. It'll be close. It looked like he had room to the outside for much more yardage, but he took it inside, or at least went straight ahead, and got tackled by Jabril Peppers from here. Looks like he's comfortably short of the first down, and he is. John O'Neill doesn't even need the chains.
It's interesting. They brought in number 34, Jeremy Clark, who's a backup. He's matching up against Villeman, the tall wide receiver. Clark is 6'4", 205. He's the biggest cornerback that Michigan has. So they're going to try to work that matchup to make sure that Villeman's not able to take advantage of some of their smaller cover corners. Now, he got away from Clark on that one, got a lot of help on the inside. But watch that matchup the rest of this game.
I think it's a good counterpunch by Michigan, and I'll tell you, Jabril Peppers came out of nowhere to save what you said, a possible touchdown, because there was a lot of green in front of Villeman.
Still, if he took it toward the boundary, he had enough running room to get the first down. Drake Johnson has come in at tailback. They give it to the fullback, Joe Kerridge. From walk-on to team captain as a fifth-year senior.
I haven't seen that play since I've played here. Tackle fullback out of the I formation, a direct handoff. I love it. Old school.
I love when Jim Harbaugh got into coaching and Bo Schembechler, one of his idols, asked him, "You got to have a fullback, Jimmy." "Yes, coach." "Are you going to have a tight end?" "Yes, coach." Because there are a lot of teams now that don't play with fullbacks and tight ends. Drake Johnson is coming back from two knee injuries. Jim said he'll probably get three or four carries at the most today. They're trying to ease him back into action.
And don't underestimate how important that was for Drake, just to get his confidence and get his first hit in game action. And he'll get faster and speedier as the season goes on and the more hits he takes.
Third down and four. Rudock given plenty of time, and his throw is way over the head of Jake Butt, who was well covered. And Michigan is just one out of five on third down.
Well, that's a matchup they want. Not only was it overthrown, but the ball was way late. Jake Butt was open, and that's the throw that Jake Rudock needs to make for this offense to be successful, not only to keep drives alive, but to give something for a defense to defend.
Good coverage by Devin Chappelle. Ramel Dockery back for the punt from Blake O'Neill. Wind at his back. Low line drive, returnable. Flag down. Great return, likely coming back. Dockery brought it across midfield. Punt, 32-yard return, but that is going to be wiped out.
30-yard return. Illegal block in the back. Return team number 14. 10-yard penalty. First down.
That's a mental error right there. He looked like he tried to hold up. And I'd like to see guys throw their hands up, but if he would have threw his hands up without touching and just kind of body bumped him, that's a way to kind of bend the rules a little bit. Not that I'm a proponent of that, but
they're one of the most penalized teams in the country last year. As you saw, just under 9 penalties per game in the final season under Mike Riley. Only Texas Tech and Baylor were penalized more often in terms of number of penalties per game. And it bothered Gary Anderson. They had a number of key penalties, particularly third down penalties on offense last week. So this drive starts at the 13. Collins, the nifty footwork. Whoa! Up and over and down at the 21-yard line. Sent airborne by Jared Wilson and Jabril Peppers.
Watch the move he makes on Godin. I mean, this is what he can bring. He's going to save some yards just by his athletic ability. Now, that's dumb. And he'll learn how to do this. And it's dumb because he's young. What he has to do is slide to protect himself because he's valuable to the team on the field, not off of it.
We do expect to see the backup, Marcus McMarion, who played in the opener as well. They intend to get him in for at least a series or two. Second quarter here in Ann Arbor, Sean McDonough, Chris Spielman, Todd McShay down on the field. Oregon State leading 7-3. They outgained the Wolverines 136-48 in the first quarter. Seth Collins yanked down after he crossed the line to make. Joe Bolden, another tackle. First down, Oregon State. The Beavers at their own 26.
And Joe Bolden saves a touchdown. They're in man coverage. Chris Brown gets a great lead block on the edge player outside. It almost went to the house. A good football player, very instinctive.
I mentioned from Coleraine High School in Cincinnati, his uncle was his head coach, his dad is athletic director. Victor Bolden the catch. Jared Wilson the tackle. We'll mark it across the 30, a gain of 5. Second down and 5 for Oregon State.
It's a family affair down there in Coleraine. Cousins and brothers playing, and dad's traveling all over trying to watch everybody.
Seth Collins growing up in Southern California always wanted to be a Pac-12 quarterback. Didn't have any offers to be a quarterback. Chris Brown, the ball carrier. He had Pac-12 offers as a wide receiver. He was going to San Jose State. He had committed to play for the Spartans. And then Gary Anderson got hired. He wanted to run an offense with the quarterback running the ball with regularity. Dave Baldwin, his offensive coordinator, had been recruiting Seth Collins at Colorado State. They made a call on a Tuesday. He came up for a quick visit. On Thursday of that same week in January, he was enrolled as a student and taking classes in Corvallis. Third down and 3. Collins throws, caught. Good catch by Caleb Smith. He's chopped down across the 40. First down, Jordan Lewis the tackle. First catch of the season for Caleb Smith.
A sign of growth and development, allowing a play to develop underneath you. They clear out with wide receivers and bring Caleb Smith on a little tight end delay. Let's get the first down, and Dave Baldwin made a point that Caleb Smith has to be part of this offense for it to operate on all cylinders.
Blew a tire, but got the first down. 9-yard gain. Chris Brown back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. Stuffed by Chris Wormley, among others.
It's the type of quarterback that Gary Anderson, you mentioned, he wanted at Wisconsin. You know, you weren't getting that out of Joel Staube. Even anybody else they put in, or Tanner McAvoy, that wasn't the guy. This is the true spread option quarterback that he's coveted. He's got him. He has a chance to grow him for 4 years at Oregon State.
Deltron Sanders picks his way across the 45-yard line. And Chris, we mentioned at the top of the telecast, it surprised many. First of all, when Mike Riley left to go to Nebraska, Mike had been the head coach at Oregon State for 14 years over two stints, including the last 12 seasons. He was 62 years old. Said he had time for one more adventure. Took the job at Nebraska. That was a surprise, and perhaps an even bigger surprise was when Gary Anderson left that Wisconsin program that's been rolling for many years now to take over a rebuilding job in Corvallis. Third down and 7. Collins has a lot of running room. Great tackle. He ran out of room quickly because of the play in space by Delano Hill.
He's an excellent athlete. They're excited about his contribution on defense, and that's a heck of an open field tackle. And right here, Seth Collins realizes this is not a Weber State athlete, this is a Michigan athlete. Good open field tackle, keeping his feet underneath him, and it wraps him up.
So on 4th and 7, Nick Perebski on to punt, now with the wind at his back. Jabril Peppers, dangerous return man, back at his own 17. They came after the kick. Horebski got it off a wobbler and a good one. Peppers at the 13. Helmet ripped off, and here come flags. Ryan Navarro, the long snapper down there in coverage. 42-yard putt, 4-yard return, and then a beheading.
Hey, interesting point about Gary Anderson, and you're going back to Wisconsin. And
personal foul, face mask, number 16 of the kicking team. 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
No. To me, it's just a case, Sean. He wasn't on the same page with Barry Alvarez. That's why he left, and that's fine. No hard feelings. I'm going my way.
He describes it as a good fit at Oregon State. Definitely feels like fall here at the Big House. 58 degrees, and with the 15-mile-per-hour breeze, it feels even cooler than that. It was in the 40s here this morning when our crew arrived bright and early for Sports Center, which emanated from the Big House, starring Todd McShay and Chris Spielman with a demonstration on the field that is definitely going to be nominated for an Emmy. Jake Rudock on the roll, on the run, and pursued out of bounds. Chased across the boundary by Levante Barnett, but a good gain on first down. Gain of 7 for Rudock, who's pursuing a master's in kinesiology, graduated in pre-med at Iowa, and wants to be a pediatrician someday. He hopes to keep playing football, but when that ends, he's going to head on to med school.
Bright guy, smart, getting an opportunity here at Michigan, and what he needs to do now is get this offense to establish something consistent on the ground.
Davion Smith in trouble, managed to pick up a yard, but he's still too shy of the first down. Caleb Solo to stop.
The problem with Davion Smith is he's a power guy and a great effort guy, but he will not make anybody miss. And it's not all his problem, because Solo, number 35, the linebacker, made the play, disengages, and the Michigan offensive line aren't sustaining blocks. That's how you create holes. Sustain and make people miss.
Third down and 2, 10 minutes to go till halftime. Oregon State leading 7-3. Rudock fires, wide open receiver Amara Darboh, given plenty of cushion for the easy first down to the 48.
Now, I know it's early in the second quarter. That was a big conversion. Michigan really needs to get a drive going. They need to keep their defense off the field, but most importantly, they just need to get some offensive confidence. They've given up 159 total yards to just 56 on offense. So they need to get Jake Butt going at the tight end position. They need to get the run game going. This is a big drive, I think, for the Wolverines in the second half, in the second quarter.
Well, they need to keep throwing the ball on first down, then establish the running game on second and third down.
Rudock, another quick throw. Darboh, nice run after the catch, and then he got planted in Beaver territory. Justin Strong knocked him down at the 48-yard line. 4 yards on the play for the Wolverines.
Oh, that's their best running play, the quick screen. That was their best running play against Utah. That's their best running play so far against Oregon State. But it does give you some options on second and 5 or second and 6.
Big bodies on the field, 2 fullbacks, Carriage and Poggi, leading the way to the right. They run right to the strength of that formation. And Davion Smith, very close to a first down. Cyril Nolan Lewis, the junior safety from Ruston, Louisiana, made the stop for Oregon State.
And that's what the definition of power. Power football and the power play. When you're allowing Ben Braden, number 71, to run through the line of scrimmage as a pulling guard free to the second level, you will always gain positive yards.
And Braden is back in at guard after limping off earlier. And a power formation. Tight end at each end of the line. The fullback is Carriage. Smith, the tailback. They snap it with 1 second on the clock. Davion Smith rumbles down to the 33 and a first down for Michigan.
pad level and sustaining. That's what the offensive line needs to do, and you're going to see it right here. Look at the pad level right here on your tight end by A.J. Williams. Smashing that corner in, creating running space.
And Chris, sometimes it's just a mentality. You know, we're Michigan. You're coming to the big house. We're going to line up. We're going to run to the power of the formation, and we're going to pick up the first down. We got six or seven to go. We got two downs to do it, and we're just going to line up and do it. I think this is Harbaugh football and Michigan football, and it's good to see it.
Reminiscent of the way they played at Stanford, Drake Harris belted down for a loss by Treston DeCoo.
Drake Harris looks at his buddy, Grant Perry. Help me out. You got to get a block. Grant was out there throwing a no-hitter. Look at number nine, who did a fine job of blocking last week, and he's just going to miss right here on Deku, who comes up with a solid open field tackle. Head up, eyes up, wrap up.
Ty Isaac, the running back, on the left hip of Rudock. Five-man rush. Rudock got it off to Jake Butt. Driven back by Justin Strong. He'll mark it at the 28-yard line. It'll be third down and five. Rudock throws, has his man. First down, flag down. Ian Bunting, the tight end, with his first catch of the ball game. Devin Chappelle, the tackle, 7-yard gain. But a flag thrown by the official on the near sideline.
That ball was designed to go to Butt all the way. They had three receivers on one side come over and run pick routes to clear Jake Butt, who was coming from a single receiver side. Thus, you get the offensive interference.
Pass interference. Offense, number 86. 15 yards from the previous spot. Repeat third down.
Drive a coach crazy because it's a mental error, because you don't need to do it. Watch J.U. Chesson right here. He doesn't need to do that. Jake Butt's way past him. That guy's not covering him. You got to play smart to be effective. Well-designed play, a Jim Harbaugh play. You don't need to block behind the ball, or you're the intended receiver.
No question about the call. Although I don't think Jim feels that way. So it's third down and 20. They're out of field goal range at the 43-yard line and working into that 15-mile-per-hour breeze. Davion Smith, the running back, to Rudock's right. Five-man rush picked up. Rudock zings one. Amara Darbough battling for every inch. He won't get the first down. But he put them in a position where it could be a long field goal try, or Jim Harbaugh might want to go for it on fourth down and five.
I think he's made that decision. Mm-hmm. I think it's Jake Butt time. I get the sense that as this game progresses, that they're starting a little bit to find their timing as an offense, and they're finding their rhythm both in the passing game and the running game.
Coach Harbaugh trying to quiet the crowd. Fourth and five from the Oregon State 28. Rudock, just a three-man rush. Man wide open. First down, Davion Smith. Weaving inside the 10 and belted down by Monyea. First and goal, Michigan.
50-year senior starting a quarterback. Bring something to the table. That's eyes. Using their eyes to draw defenders to Jake Butt and allowing Smith to clear into the flat.
I'm standing in the end zone just watching his eyes, Chris, as you're talking about. He checks from one receiver to the next, got to his third read to pick up that first.
And they rushed three, and yet Smith was wide open. Now he carries and battles inside the three. Took Cyril Nolan Lewis for a ride. Second and goal, Michigan, trying to take the lead.
Now, Davion's not the fastest guy, but I can tell you this. Nobody's going to give more effort at the running back position than number four for the Wolverines. They got a rhythm going, don't you? I sense it. They got a rhythm. That's something that Oregon State's going to have to adjust to.
Well, Jim Harbaugh's biggest frustrations last week at Utah was the lack of consistent effort. The players concurred. They felt like they're capable of giving more. Flag down. Substitution infraction, I believe. Somebody might have too many men in the field.
Illegal substitution. Defense, 12 players in formation. Half the distance to the goal. 3 feet second down.
That's a mental error as Gary Anderson's yelling at his defensive coordinator. Can we get the substitution correct, please? But when an offense develops a rhythm, then coordinators sometimes try to counter or get fresh bodies in there. As you see Coach Satake right there, outstanding defensive coordinator.
Came over from Utah. He was the coordinator there the last 6 years. Second and goal. Smith trying to bounce it outside and into the end zone. Touchdown, Michigan, and the lead for the Wolverines.
You saw it at San Diego. You saw it at Stanford. You saw it in San Francisco. Now you're seeing it here with Joe Karich getting a kickout block on Cyril Nolulis. Creates the open corner for North and South. Davion Smith.
His first touchdown of his junior season. He hails from Warren, Ohio. 12 plays, 69 yards. Michigan leads for the first time, and it's 10-7 after the extra point from Kenny Allen. 4:03 to go in the home opener for Jim Harbaugh at Michigan.
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by Ford. We go further so you can. And Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and college football. It's a one-of-a-kind tradition.
Back at the Big House Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor. Michigan has taken its first lead of the day. 10-7 over Oregon State. 4:03 to go in the first half.
Confidence boost. I mean, you just sense the momentum changing, and Oregon State's defense has got to come back and counter of how they're going to stop that power O as this game moves forward.
Kenny Allen kicks off out of bounds. So each team has done that today into the wind.
Kick
There's
team.
A flag down.
Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line.
And apparently it's only for the kick out of bounds. There was one thrown right in the middle of the field, and it's still on the field, so there might be something else as well. John O'Neill huddling with his crew.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Receiving team, number 10. Ball be placed half the distance from the spot. First down.
Caleb Smith a little too frisky. And that hurts. Instead of starting at the 35, they'll start at the 20 when we come back. Here's a look at the penalty on the kickoff against Oregon State. Caleb Smith circled artfully by Chris Spielman.
If you want to be good, you want to be consistent as a football team, you got to cut out the stupid penalties. That's not discipline, and that's not Gary Anderson football. It's stupid.
You're going to hit somebody who's already lying flat on the ground as the ball's out of bounds is not a good idea. From the 20, Seth Collins out throwing to Victor Bolden. Nice play and good run after the catch. All the way out to the 36-yard line, perhaps the 37. They're going to spot it back at the 36, a gain of 16.
And speaking of discipline, Jordan Lewis, you can't jump inside. We see it on both sides so far. As an outside defender on the quick screen, you must force the ball back inside. If you don't do it, you're always going to get positive yards.
Oregon State's moved the ball, but their only touchdown on the opening possession, single coverage. Jordan Villeman, the intended receiver, well defended by Channing Stribling, the junior from Matthews, North Carolina.
Now, as he grows as a quarterback and gets more timing and practice with his wide receivers, when you see the defensive back on top of your wide receivers, that's when you throw the back shoulder fade or the stop route. That will develop as he develops.
Bolden stumbled as he turned the corner. Here's Cassidy.
Thanks, Sean. Let's take a look at who's getting it done, presented by Wells Fargo. And Penn State finally getting it done on offense against Buffalo. Rainy day, but Brandon Polk holds on for a 22-yard TD run. Penn State's first point since the first quarter of their loss to Temple last week. This game on ESPN2.
First of five straight home games for Penn State, so perhaps chance to rally back after that Loss at Temple. Third down and nine. Michigan has all three timeouts left, trying to get the ball back. Collins fired one. That was a rocket, but incomplete. Intended for Bolden. They have clearly made a big effort to get the ball into the hands of Bolden today.
Victor Bolden's been inconsistent the first 2 weeks. He got tackled by the 38-yard line the last play. That ball's at his hands. He's got to get his head around and his hands up and make that play as a Division I Pac-12 football player.
Well, here's Nick Perebski on the punt. He played Australian rules football in his native country. Whoa, he gets the punt off and then gets hit, and the flag is down. That was a disaster waiting to happen, first for Oregon State and now perhaps for Michigan.
Personal foul, left in the kicker. Defense number 34. 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Well, the ball is bobbled. I think Jim is arguing if the ball is bobbled that the punter is live. Could turn into a runner.
Harbaugh irate on the sideline. Well, we have one of our rules experts, Dave Kataya, here. Dave, what do you think Jim is so upset about? Dave's mic is not open. We'll get back to Dave in a moment.
What he's upset about is the fact that the kicker's outside the tackle box. Roughing the kicker goes away, so the only thing you can call if you call it unnecessary roughness. Not sure that's there.
More is Jim. And now a timeout called by Michigan. So it's first down Oregon State. And a tantrum that would make Bo Schembechler proud on the Michigan sideline in his home debut for Coach Harbaugh. Well, let's go back and take a look at this again. A big call. Nick Perebski trying to punt. Dave Kataya, our rules official, what say you?
All right, you saw the circle by Chris there. The tackle's outside. This hit is clearly outside the tackle box, but you can hit the punter like that, but it can be unnecessary roughness for the shoulder.
Apparently that was the call from John O'Neill. Jim Harbaugh didn't like it. Seth Collins now on first and 10. Throws it up for grabs, and it's incomplete. Intended for Jordan Villeman. With Jordan Lewis in coverage, and they are both slow to get up.
An outstanding play by Jordan Lewis.
He's wobbly. He's going to have to come off.
It's a good ball by Seth Collins trying to throw it to the 6'5 Villeman, but you see Jordan Lewis not worrying about catching the ball, using one hand as opposed to two so he can get to the highest point and fight Villeman for that jump ball, knock it away.
Both of them injured on the play. Lewis started to walk off and then went to a knee. And undoubtedly they'll put him through the concussion protocol. This is Jim Harbaugh after the punt. You can see him gesturing, and I think his point is that he was outside the tackle box and therefore fair game. You can see Jim keeps pointing toward the sideline. It's a rugby kick.
I think the fans love to see that.
Absolutely, they do. He is a fiery competitor. And when you talk to people about Jim, those are words you hear so often.
You know, the best part about meeting with Coach Harbaugh yesterday was when he got up on a table in the cafeteria in a three-point stance. And he was trying to make a point that, you know, he feels like with young players going from the NFL to college football, you got to go back and you can't take fundamentals for granted. You got to teach from step one every part of the game.
Collins, after the run fake, yanks it down and takes off running, and a good decision. He got eight. It'll be third down and two. Ryan Glasgow tripped him up. And Jim was trying to make the point that he had to teach about 50 guys just how to get into a three-point stance. And he was trying to demonstrate how poor some of the stances were. And he literally stood on his chair in a cafeteria table, got up on the table. We were all concerned he might flip the table over, and demonstrated what his players were doing that was incorrect and how he corrected them.
Yeah, that was about 2 seconds from a flashback myself when I saw him getting that three-point stance.
Third down and two. Design run for Collins, and he goes nowhere. Dropped for a bit of a loss. spun away from James Ross, who blew up the play, and then Chris Wormley finished off Collins. And a decision to make for Gary Anderson, and for the time being, the offense is on the field on fourth down and three with under 2 minutes to go in the half.
At the very least, I think what you do is try to draw them off sides with the hard count, which we see every week in college football. To me, on the road, you punt the football.
And perhaps that's what he's going to do. He might just take the clock all the way down and try not to leave Michigan much time left. Both teams with two timeouts remaining here in the first half.
Here's what I would do in this situation. You're an up-tempo offense. You should have it pre-planned. Run up to the line of scrimmage like you're going to run a play. You're getting them confused and jacked up on a fourth down. They think you're going to snap the ball in a hurry. Then at the very least, you have nothing to lose if you go hard count. Nothing at all.
Oregon State elected not to use the timeout. They took a delay of game instead, so they're just going to punt and give the punter a little more room with the wind at his back. And now confusion on the Michigan sideline. I think they had the defense out on the field, at least in safe punt mode. They want different personnel out there, and that could be big, because now they have just one timeout left as they prepare to get the ball back with a minute and a half to go till halftime. Here's a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Jim Harbaugh making his home debut as head coach at Michigan after a loss in the opener at Utah. Seth Collins had a lot of good moments here in the first half for Oregon State, including a touchdown pass to Hunter Jarman having their opening drive. Michigan has scored 10 unanswered points. Davion Smith, the touchdown from in close, and then Kenny Allen, the field goal that has put Michigan up by three.
See, Michigan is keeping their defense, obviously, to defend against any fake.
Safety first mode here. Perebski punts, gets a nice bounce, and it goes out of bounds inside the two. ...42-yard punt. Beautifully done by Perebski.
Hey, McDonough, that was like you with your sandwich, man.
Spin it back, baby. Spin it back.
Well, if it had been like Todd's, it would have been shanked into the water.
Absolutely. Well, hey, watch it, Spielman.
Perebski, one of those we mentioned, played Australian rules football and then got invited to a kicking academy. Well, now they're going to bring the ball back.
Yeah, late flag.
Apparently there was a flag that went unseen by just about everybody in the stadium.
And for me, Sean, with Jabril Peppers, you got to field the football. Mm-hmm. You got at least fair catch it, because you cannot take a chance on the ball with a funky bounce or your sandwich spin coming back into play. Get as many yards as you can. You got a minute 19 left. And if you're feeling aggressive, you get the ball and you run your 2 minute drill right down the field.
Perebski used punting as a means to come to the United States and get a college education. He started out at Snow College in Utah. Very high snap. That illegal formation penalty is going to be huge now. Perebski, reminiscent of his days playing Australian rules football, is tackled at the 3-yard line. An enormous mistake by Oregon State. Ryan Navarro, the long snapper, didn't come close.
That's the second bad snap in a row on the punt. You remember the one where they had the roughing the kicker over his head? And again, that one's over his head.
Boy, that could be a game changer. 48 yards. How important was that illegal formation penalty? Perebski had knocked the ball down to the 2-yard line. Now the ball's on the three going in for Michigan.
Jim Harbaugh had him huddled up. I guarantee you they're going to try to power it in, getting everybody fired up and to establish their dominance and who and what they want to be.
Well, that formation, reminiscent of his days at Stanford when they played goal line offense up and down the field, even in the center of the field. Davion Smith didn't get in. And the clock will run under a minute to go in the first half. One one timeout left for Michigan. I believe, taking a handoff in the pile. And will they use that timeout? The clock's still running. Tim Drebno in the background, the offensive coordinator. They're not going to use the timeout. Now Gary Anderson will. Coming up at the half, stay tuned for John Saunders, Mark May, Mac Brown, the Cooper Tires halftime report, scores and highlights from all around college football, and their outstanding analysis as usual. And Chris, in a tight game like this, that bad snap, that could wind up in the final analysis being a fatal play.
Yeah, absolutely. You almost think he should have ran through the end zone and took two points, but right now their defense is playing pretty stout, so... If you're Jim Harbaugh here, the one thing you don't want to do, you want to leave with some points. You have to get points on the board to get it to a touchdown as opposed to a field goal lead, and just to keep establishing your confidence in your offense.
It would be a huge stop for Oregon State if they could force a field goal. And I've been very impressed. They only scored so far, the Beavers, on the opening drive of the football game. But Seth Collins, as we said, a little jittery when we met with him last night, and the coaches worried about his anxiety level in this venue. They've moved the ball.
Yeah, he's done a good job of protecting the football. It's the number one rule for a young quarterback, all quarterbacks, is not turn the ball over.
Michigan still has a timeout, as does Oregon State. Third down and goal. Davion Smith behind Joe Kerridge.
Got to alert Jake Button right here now. A lot of teams like to run a little tight end delay. He's not number 88 right here in your pitcher. A big red zone target.
You have Henry Pogge on the field as well. And A.J. Williams, Pogge, a fullback, 19. The right end of the line, and A.J. Williams, tight end, 84, just inside him. Don't know what they're waiting for. We're told they might be adding time. They did. 3 seconds added to the game clock. Stops and starts at the end of the half. Smith starts with the handoff and ends in the end zone.
You want a physical offensive line. You want a guy that's athletic enough to pull. You want a guy to get a knockdown block on the goal line to establish your identity of Jim Harbaugh and being a Michigan Wolverine, and you get it right there by Big Ben Braden clearing the hole. The thing is, Sean, he's getting momentum upfield. They're not beating him in the backfield. He's beating them beyond the line of scrimmage.
Well, the biggest play of this football game so far, the high snap after a penalty against Oregon State. Kenny Allen adds the extra point. Davion Smith, the touchdown, his second of the game. He has scored both touchdowns for Michigan. And the Wolverines lead by 10. 12 seconds to go in the half. Jim Harbaugh, part of what really is the first family of coaching in the United States right now. Jim, of course, ultra successful everywhere he's been, including the 49ers, took them to the Super Bowl, where he lost head-to-head against his brother, the great John Harbaugh, head coach of the Ravens, both mentored by their wonderful dad, Jack, who won a national championship at Western Kentucky. And their brother-in-law, Jim and John's, is Tom Crean, the basketball coach at Indiana, who went to the Final Four with Dwayne Wade and Marquette in 2003. Jim and John right behind the bench. Jim and John's sister, Joni, who got all the good looks among the siblings in their family, is married to Tom Crean. Jack Harbaugh, the dad, the mom, Jackie. And for as animated as we've seen Jim get with the officials, Jackie Harbaugh might be the roughest member of the family. I've sat with her at games, and she'll get after you. Dave Kataya nodding his head. I think he might have run into Mrs. Harbaugh along the trail. Jack and Jackie here today watching their son's home debut. Kenny Allen picks it in the end zone, into the wind. Dockery took a knee. Let's hear what some of Michigan's players said about their new coach.
The dude is intense.
Intense. Enthusiastic.
He's definitely a teacher of the game. And I gotta say he's crazy, man. He's probably gonna kill me for that, but he's definitely been one of the craziest coaches I've played for. But it's a good kind of crazy, you know? It makes you want to be crazy.
I think he's the perfect fit, Sean. Mm-hmm. He's a great competitor. I loved playing against him. I love watching him coach, and his teams will always come to fight in the good way.
Collins takes the knee. It wasn't always pretty for Jim Harbaugh's Wolverines, but they take advantage of the critical error by Oregon State on the punt at the end of the half to lead by 10. 17-7, they'll get the ball to start the second half. John, Mark, and Mac, the Cooper Tires halftime report right after these messages.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
We're back at Michigan Stadium. Time to take a look at today's halftime double check brought to you by State Farm. Michigan leading 17-7 at the half, despite the fact that the Wolverines had just five first downs in the half. Oregon State scored on its first possession. They went 79 yards on seven plays. The rest of the half, 55 yards on 30 plays. So the offense, after a good start, Chris, really struggled for Oregon State. They're going to have to find some if they're going to come back in the second half, obviously.
Well, they had success running the ball outside early, but I think their biggest way of getting something going is get Seth Collins going on the ground. Now, for Michigan, they're starting to establish themselves on the line of scrimmage, and they're winning a physical battle, and we'll see if that carries over into the second half where they start wearing down the Beaver defense.
Oregon State with some key mistakes in that first half, most notably the high snap, which resulted in a 95-yard change in field position. And the punter probably, with hindsight, should have picked that up and run it into the end zone, or just kicked it through the back of the end zone and taken the safety.
A lot of times coaches say that's what you do. You take the safety and the 2 points, but they had them down to third down. If they would have held them, that would have been a win for Oregon State to go into the locker room with by just giving up a field goal.
Well, it looked like late in the half that Oregon State had done a great job on special teams. They were lined up to punt, and in fact, Perebski punted it down to the 2-yard line where there was an illegal formation. You can't have more than four in the backfield, and the player at the top of your screen was too far off the line. Judged to be five in the backfield, and therefore that punt was nullified. And then on the follow-up play, the very high snap by Ryan Navarro led to a touchdown for Michigan just before the half. Jabril Peppers is going to try to run it out, and he is tripped up at the 10-yard line. Dadron Guyton with good coverage for the Oregon State Beavers. Let's take a look at today's AT&T strong performance.
Look, hardly Andrew Luck so far, but Jake Rudock from Michigan doing a very good job managing the offense. One of the things is going through his progression. You see, he starts to the right, doesn't find what he wants. Then he comes back to the middle of the field, still doesn't find what he wants. Then he goes to Davion Smith, the running back, and Smith pounds it down inside the 10-yard line. Those are the little things that we're seeing from Rudock as he develops within this, you know, Jim Harbaugh offensive system that are really promising.
Todd, I think we both agree that he didn't see the field very well last week against Utah. I think he's seen the field much better today.
Completely agree.
There's a fumble. Davion Smith coughed it up. Titus Failauga knocked it out. Jake Butt was in the right spot for Michigan. He actually wound up gaining a yard on the play.
Sometimes you do a good job and get lucky if you don't get your block. Jake Butt does not get his block on Failauga, but he's there to clean up his mistake by recovering the fumble. Lucky by Jake Butt.
Butt goes in motion. Ty Isaac in at running back now. Design roll to the left. Perudon dumped it off in the flat. Jake Butt has a first down as he lunged across the line to make. Picked it up by a yard. Justin Strong, the tackler for the Beavers. Third catch of the ball game for the junior from Pickerington, Ohio, Jake Butt.
Sean, you got to know your personnel. You got to understand Rudock's not going to hurt you throwing the football. There was no reason for the defender to attack Rudock, vacating your coverage on the number one target in Jake Butt. Another mental error by the Beaver defense. A tackle over Mason Cole, now going over to play tight end up top of your screen.
And leading the way were Davion Smith. He got stood up and then moved the pile forward. Gain of 9. Justin Strong, Cyril Nolan Lewis, the safeties combined on the play.
Just noticed all day long, Davion Smith missed a bunch of holes last week when we studied the tape. This week, he seems like he's running with a lot more confidence. You see him finding his hole, getting north and south, and then delivering blows rather than being stood up in the hole.
Well, the offensive line, Todd, is actually creating seams for him to have open holes by their pad level, and they're moving people off the line of scrimmage down the field.
This helmet came off. He went out. Ty Isaac, the running back. Rudock faked it to him, then steps into a throw. It's a rocket to A.J. Williams into Beaver territory and down at the 47-yard line. Knocked down by Caleb Solo.
9 different receivers caught balls from Jake Rudock last week. He loves to spread the wealth. Right there's the patience. He can have patience because he has time to step up in the pocket, allowing the receiver to clear. You see him step through that throw. He does have a strong arm when he can rifle through that throw with his back foot.
5 different receivers have caught balls today. First catch of the day for A.J. Williams for 22. Rudock over the middle. Caught by Ty Isaac. Thrown down near the first down yardage by David Henry, a backup linebacker. It looks like they'll be about a half yard short.
Love the play calling of Tim Drevno, the offensive coordinator, and Jim Marbaugh, mixing it up on first downs. That loosens it up and allows for that running game to get going because you get your defense on its heels, forcing them to play a type of zone so they're safe against the pass and a run.
Drevno also coaches the offensive line. They could be much more pleased with their pad level today than he was a week ago. Ty Isaac carries for the first down to the 33-yard line. Monday Night Football is back with a Week 1 doubleheader at 6:55 Eastern Time. Chip Kelly and those revamped Philadelphia Eagles take on the new head coach of the Falcons, Dan Quinn, and his Atlanta squad. And then at 10:15, Adrian Peterson and the Minnesota Vikings against Colin Kaepernick and Jim Harbaugh's former team, the San Francisco 49ers. What a job Jim did there 3 times to the NFC title game, then a trip to the Super Bowl. Starts at 5 Eastern with Countdown, brought to you by Applebee's. Rudock's pass is knocked down. Jalen Grimble, big number 10, transferred from the University of Miami.
Big Paul up in the air. Hey, I'm anxious to see, speaking of Monday Night Football, the growth of Teddy Bridgewater from a first year, pretty successful campaign as a rookie to the second year.
Now, will you be able to watch without high anxiety? Chris's brother Rick is the general manager of the Minnesota Vikings.
You know, actually what I do, I don't watch. I get in the truck and drive around and listen to it on the radio because I can't watch. It's a sickness I have. Yes, I can listen.
I'm glad you listen someplace, because here in the booth that does not happen. Davion Smith, another powerful run, refusing to go down, and finally taken to the turf at the 14-yard line. 19-yard run.
Hey, the most valuable player on the offense today is Ben Brady, because he's clearing the holes so Davion Smith can use his vision. Look, there's no cuts to be made. Just north and south, straight ahead, Ed. That's what he is. That's what he does best. And Ben Brady has been leading the way all day for number 4, Davion Smith.
Up to 73 yards rushing for Davion Smith. A blitz from the other side. Justin Strong came on a safety blitz. Davion ran away from him to the 9-yard line. Joshua James made the tackle for Oregon State. Michigan trying to take control of the game. 4 minutes into the second half, trying to add on a 10-point lead.
You know, in the first quarter, we talked about this power running game of Michigan. Will it wear out the Oregon State defense? And right now, that's what's happening, Sean. They're taking control of the line of scrimmage. This is what Jim Harbaugh envisions for an offense. Right down your throat, punching the mouth. Here we come, and there's nothing you can do to stop us.
Long time in the huddle, and they're going to have to use a timeout with the 10th play of this opening drive of the second half upcoming. They started at their own 11-yard line. They're at the Oregon State 9 after this.
Affleck.
Today's Affleck trivia question. Jim Harbaugh is one of three active FBS head coaches who were head coaches in the National Football League for at least 3 years. Can you name the other two? And I'm not sure I'm going to ask you, Chris, because despite morality, you are a serial cheater when it comes to the Affleck trivia question.
Serial find a way to get a winner.
You're not cheating, you're not trying. Second and 5, Michigan. Straight ahead again with Davion Smith, and the Beavers say that's enough of that. Justin Strong up from his safety spot. Romo Mungiau also in there. Carriage comes off with the apparent right arm injury, maybe a stinger.
Big loss for them if he stays off. Captain, tough guy, former walk-on, excellent lead blocker, good hands out of the backfield. Homa's in now.
Third and 2, there's a big play. Michigan touchdown, they get a 3-score game and a lot of movement prior to the snap. A lot of penalties in the first half. Both teams penalized 5 times.
Ball start. Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
Graham Glasgow, the center. One of the things Michigan did well last year actually was avoid penalties in a 5-7 season. Win total went down each of the 4 years under Brady Hoke. Rudock, single coverage, a lot of contact, no flag throw. Amari Darboe wrestling with Larry Scott.
Larry Scott grabbed his jersey.
Boy, it sure looked like it, didn't it?
Yeah, with his right hand, he grabs the jersey of Amari Darboe. It's a nice little back shoulder fade. And without the jersey grab, he has no way to defend this football. Watch here. Watch the jersey. You see him pull him in right there. That should be a penalty. You can't miss that as an official. That's too obvious, and it's right in front of your face.
Yeah, that was clearly missed. And a big stop. Field goal would keep Oregon State within 2 scores. 29-yard try for Kenny Allen. And he's 2 for 2 today. Harbaugh, in more than 100,000, can't believe the lack of a flag here inside the big house.
ESPN's College Football on ABC. Brought to you by the all-new Honda Pilot. It's ready for anything. Jiffy Lube. Experts around every corner to help you leave worry behind. And Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich.
Aerial coverage of today's game provided by Goodyear. Everything Goodyear has learned making tires that go the distance inspires what they rolled into yours. Goodyear, more driven. Michigan trailed 7-0. They've scored 20 unanswered points. Their last 3 possessions, 2 touchdowns by Davion Smith and now a field goal by Kenny Allen, who kicks off. Down to Ramel Dockery, who forgot to take the ball with him. And did well to battle across the 20-yard line. Delano Hill made the tackle for Michigan. Here's the answer to today's Affleck trivia question. Chris, do you want to guess before we reveal the answer?
I know Jim Moore for sure, but I'll let the viewers guess.
And the other one, we saw him last week, and well known, of course, to Oregon State fans, Mike Riley. I believe Jim Harbaugh, at least briefly, was a quarterback for the Chargers.
Yes, he was.
Mike Riley
absolutely
was the coach there. Storm Woods at running back. He's been a staple for the last several years. Played sparingly today. Split carries with Chris Brown last week.
get a face mask here, I believe, on Boris Woods.
Woods was the ball carrier. Joe Bolden on the tackle.
Personal foul, face mask. Defense number 35. 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
Woods' first carry of the day, and tack 15 on for the face mask against Joe Bolden.
It'll be interesting to see what Oregon State wants to do here in the second half. I think you have to stick with what they're doing. They had six more first downs in the first half. I think you have to mix the run and pass. You're only down 13 points. They just have to stop with the mistakes and finish some drives.
Pass dropped. Intended for Caleb Smith.
You know, along those lines, Todd, with Seth Collins, he's got to become the main factor in the running game. And I'm not talking about just designed runs. In the passing game, he's got to be a one and done. A first read, it's not there. Use your God-given ability and run the football and take it downfield to get positive yards. That will put pressure on the Wolverine defense.
Collins 0 for his last four, though that one was on Smith. Here's Storm Bars Woods again, sixth all-time leading rusher in the history of the program. Those are his first two carries of the game. Here's Cassidy back in the studio.
Thanks, Sean. Taco Bell studio update. Fans on alert on the plains. Number six Auburn struggling with FCS opponent Jacksonville State. Jeremy Johnson, though, with a 51-yard TD pass to Rock Thomas to give Auburn the 13-10 lead in the third. This game over on the SEC Network.
Here it's third down and seven for Oregon State. Quarterback dropped, and they were ready for it. We're the Wolverines. Mario Ojemudia leading the defense.
They ran this once in the first half and had success. This time they don't have success because your inside rushers are maintaining their rush lanes and closing anything down. They're not getting upfield. And Ojemudi is on a little bit of a stunt. Just comes back inside, staying disciplined, not getting upfield to create a running lane.
Nick Perebski will keep an eye on the snap from Ryan Navarro. He's had a couple that were high, including one that sailed over Perebski's head. That one's on target. And they rushed the punter again. Perebski got it off. Jabril Peppers, the fair catch at the 11-yard line. Well, after she pulled off an upset for the ages, Roberta Vinci will meet Flavia Panetta in an all-Italian women's final at the U.S. Open, presented by Mercedes-Benz. That's coming up at the top of the hour, 3 Eastern time on ESPN. Also streaming live on Watch ESPN. If you haven't downloaded the app, now would be a good time to do it. Big surprise in that final. Of course, Vinci knocked off Serena Williams, ending her shot. She won the U.S. Open. She would have won the Grand Slam. All in the same calendar year. Vinci was gracious in victory yesterday. Apologized to the crowd for kind of ruining that whole part of it. Here's Davion Smith. Bouncing off tacklers. And finally ridden down. Banged off Cyril Nolan Lewis and ahead for a few more yards. Luke Hollingsworth finally wrapped him up and got him down at the 20, an 8-yard gain.
Never apologize for winning. I get what you're saying, but the tennis player,
she's just so sorry to the crowd, but she said, hey, it's my day, and it was her day.
Absolutely.
And maybe today will be her day. She's ranked 43rd in the world. Panetta, 26th in the world. Neither one of them has ever been in a Grand Slam singles final before. So good for them, and good luck. Should be a good match. Davion Smith. Joshua James made the tackle.
Don't Davion, like Jim Harbaugh on the field of what he wants. I mean, just a fighter. He's not the most elusive guy. He doesn't have the best vision. But the one thing he does, he runs with everything he has, every single play, and always falls forward.
I think that's one of the things they're certainly lacking is that big playmaker, you know, the explosive guy who can go 80 on one play. Ty Isaac in at running back now. J.U. Chesson has good speed. He got behind the defense a couple of times last week. I haven't really tried that much today. Rudock yanked it down and took off and ran to the 27-yard line. Jalen Grimble, Romo Munyeau made the tackle.
I think that's the difference of Michigan quarterbacks in the past few years and Michigan quarterbacks now. Nothing there. Tuck the ball, number one priority. Protect the football. and just get positive yards and fall down and don't risk turning the ball over. That's what they had a problem with a few years ago, quarterbacks turning the ball over on a consistent basis.
Michigan was minus 16 last year in turnover margin, 121st in the country. You're not going to win when you have that kind of turnover margin. Davion Smith broke another ankle tackle and got the first down. He got away from Caleb Salo and Larry Scott. The man they call the commission, he shares the same name as the commissioner of the Pac-12 conference, made the tackle.
They're just imposing their will. I mean, this is, get used to this, because if you're going to watch Michigan games and you want to see spread offenses and the ball thrown all over the place, you won't see it. You'll see 35 to 40 rushes, already up to 26 today. You'll see 45 to 50, whatever it takes. He wants to run the football.
Lonnie Sitake's defense been on the field for most of this third quarter. Rudock after surveying the options. Send it out to J.U. Chesson. There's the speedster. Up the near sideline and down. Tackled by Preston DeCoud at the 48-yard line. That's a pickup of 14 for the Wolverines.
I know as a former quarterback, Todd, that you love quarterbacks that put the ball on target so a receiver doesn't have to work.
Yeah, and as a quarterback, you love receivers that'll take a little toss like that and pick up 5, 7, 10 yards. These receivers are starting to gain more and more confidence in this offense. The other thing, Chris, I love, they're blocking downfield all day long.
Yeah, that's what they have to do, and they're demanded to do that with a Jim Harbaugh-coached offense.
Davion Smith took the toss and got wrestled down to the line of scrimmage. Larry Scott made the tackle.
Fine football coach, Coach Sitake. He was going to find out how his young team was, and he wanted this type of game. The problem is his guys are on the field too long because the offense can't stay on the field. And when you're getting punched in the mouth continuously, you don't have time to catch your breath as a defense.
Game more than 40 minutes old now, and Michigan's had the ball for more than 24 minutes. Ty Isaac, the running back, it's a reverse. J.U. Chesson taken down in Beaver territory at the 48-yard line. Kyle Pecco made the stop with help from Justin Strong. Pecco's a senior, middle of that front three in the 3-4 alignment. They waited a long time for him. He had trouble getting academically eligible, and to his credit, he said he really felt bad for Mike Riley, the previous coaching staff. They could have used him, and he just didn't get it done in the classroom. Now he's eligible, and he's a factor. Third down and 5. Rudock, deep ball, far sideline, and a little bit underthrown, perhaps, intended for J.U. Chesson. And Chris, Rudock looked bad twice last week when he overthrew Chesson. And if you just watch the game, you'd say, oh, Rudock overthrew him. Jim Harbaugh said yesterday, twice after Chesson got behind the defense, he slowed down inexplicably. And Rudock didn't anticipate that part of it and threw it over his head. So he really put those two on Chesson.
Yeah, he did. And right there, that was on Rudock, because not only did he have a bad throw, he missed Grant Perry in the flat. That was his first bad read of the football game. Instead of going for the home run, he should have gone for keep the sticks moving ball to Grant Perry.
Blake O'Neill on the punt on 4th and 5. End over end into the wind, and a fair catch made by Ramel Dockery at the 14-yard line. Oregon State's run only 4 plays on offense here in the third quarter. College football doubleheader action tonight on ESPN at 6. Oklahoma and Tennessee, a top 25 matchup. And then at 9:15 Eastern, 14th-ranked LSU in Starkville to take on 25th-ranked Mississippi State. That's all tonight, starting at 6 Eastern on ESPN and streaming live on Watch ESPN. For the first time today, here's the redshirt freshman, Marcus McMarion, at quarterback. He got hit as he throws, and he throws too high over the head of Jordan Villeman. He was expected to play. Matter of fact, Dave Baldwin told us yesterday, probably in the 3rd or 4th series of the game. They want to get him experience. They have 2 freshman quarterbacks. They're the only team in the country in major college football that has, at the start of the year, no quarterback with any playing experience.
he's known more as the thrower, so it makes sense to put him in the game in this type of situation. Tough duty.
Almost had trouble with the inside handoff to Victor Bolden, who got spilled after a gain of only one by Joe Bolden. Boy, Oregon State so impressive on the opening drive of the game when they marched down the field 79 yards and seven plays and scored, and they've done almost nothing since.
You have to be two-dimensional when you play against an aggressive defense like Michigan. Only 79 yards through the air, 145 total yards, so they've been shut out completely by the Wolverines after that first drive.
They said they would play McMarion no matter how the game was going. They want to get him experience in case something happens to Collins, and there's a flinch at the right end of the line. Dustin Stanton.
Offense number 74. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Originally recruited as a tight end, a junior from Marysville, Washington. The crowd now trying to make it difficult for Stanton and the Beaver offense.
It's been a while since I've heard the Big House sound like this, to be quite honest with you. I mean, Jim Harbaugh effect is just creates energy and excitement and enthusiasm. There's just a different feel.
Oregon State 1 out of 7 on third down. Look out, McMarion buried back inside the two by Chris Wormley.
Well, he wasn't blocked last week, and he's not being blocked this week, and he's going to come with the famous Mark Spitz swim move. Take a look. Or Michael Phelps for younger generation. Look at that. Just steps inside. Doesn't worry about contain. Trusts his athletic ability. Watch a quick rip. Nice.
Wormley, he jumped out on tape last week's game constantly in the backfield. We saw that. I'm standing right, probably 15 yards away. First thing I noticed, that quick swim move to get in the backfield.
Gorebski punting out of his own end zone and just did get it off again. Jabril Peppers watches the bouncing ball, took it into the 44, then danced to the 39-yard line. Datron Guyton, the tackle. 42-yard punt, 5-yard return. Great field position for Michigan, leading by 13. 1:24 to go in the third quarter of the home opener for Jim Harbaugh, as head coach at his alma mater. Got some coaching experience in the NFL with the Raiders as an assistant, then became the head coach at the University of San Diego, where he went 29-6 during his tenure there. On to Stanford, inherited a team that won 1-11 by the final season there. They won 12 games and the Orange Bowl against Virginia Tech. And NFL fans know the great job he did with the 49ers, but it was a marriage that ended. His relationship was not great with ownership and general manager Trent Baalke. His relationship's great with Davion Smith today. He has to appreciate the job his running back has done. Ali'i Robbins and Justin Strong finally took him down after a gain of 12, and he's up to 111 yards rushing now is Davion Smith.
You know, I live in Columbus, Sean, and people always ask me, what's Jim Harbaugh going to bring to Michigan? I'm saying, it's all different now. I said, you better be warned, because Ohio State dominating that series, it's going to even out here with Jim Harbaugh, because he's that good of a coach, and he'll get that good of players to come here to Michigan.
Smith again bounces off the pile, and another first down. There's a flag down near the far hash marks. Larry Scott finally did get Smith down. His career high is 121 yards, and he's likely to surpass that today. That was at Northwestern last November 8th.
Well, he runs with bad intentions. I mean, he tries to hurt people when he runs.
Justin Strong is still down.
Personal foul, illegal block below the waist. Offense number 14. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Penalties against Drake Harris. And can't afford to lose Strong. Sophomore from Rialto, California. Leading tackler among the returning players. As we mentioned, they have only two starters back. They have the ninth youngest team in the country in FCS football. And the youngest in the Pac-12. They're picked in the preseason poll to finish last in the Pac-12 North, so expectations are not high.
Penalty, ball to the 35-yard line.
Brandon Arnold is his replacement. Sophomore from Los Angeles. Rudock blitz, stepped away from it. Got the ball off. Ian Bunting, the tight end, first down.
Drop back quarterbacks, pro-style quarterbacks, keep their eyes downfield, don't panic, and let the receivers develop in front of them.
And when pressure comes from the outside, you step up. Listen, Tom Brady's not a great athlete. Peyton Manning's not a great athlete. As long as you can maneuver within the pocket, as you said, Chris, and keep your eyes down the field, feel the rush, where it's coming from, and know whether to climb or to slide left and right, you can extend plays, and that's exactly what Rudock did just there.
Well, he's what Jim Harbaugh wants in a quarterback. He's not interested in a guy that can run. He's interested in a guy that can maneuver in the pocket, throw the ball downfield, and spread the ball around.
Boy, Jim Harbaugh will be pleased with many things in his home debut. I think more than anything else, the effort his team has put out today. They lead by 13 and moving again as we head to the fourth. We're back at Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, the home opener for Michigan football. They haven't lost at home in the home opener since 2008 when Utah spoiled Rich Rodriguez's debut as Michigan coach. Gary Anderson, the Oregon State head coach, was the defensive coordinator for that Utes team on that day. His Beavers are trailing as we head to the fourth quarter, 20-7, and it's first and 10 for Michigan on the move again at the 14-yard line of Oregon State. Derek Green has come in now at tailback. He gets the handoff. Look at that offensive line just push them downfield. Everybody went 5 yards backwards in that Oregon State uniform. Kyle Pecco made the tackle.
Well, I understand this week during practice that they worked on footwork and also playing lower. In football, the rule is the low man wins, especially at the point of attack on the line of scrimmage. And right now, those big hogs for the Wolverines are getting their pads lower and driving them off the football.
Second and four. Why not stick with it? Power football again, and a touchdown. Tired-looking Beaver defense that was on the field for almost the entire third quarter.
This is what we've seen all day. A guy that will not be denied, that wants to get in the end zone. And when you have backs run like that, that fires up the offensive linemen, and they want to block harder, and they want to sustain blocks, and they want to finish.
Career high, 126 yards rushing for Davion Smith. They're going to go for two now. Three touchdowns rushing today for Smith. Smith went in motion to the right. Rudock out of the gun. Running out of time. Caught. 2 points. It's Davion Smith's day. He scored the touchdown and makes the catch on the 2-point conversion. ...14-18 to go. 28 straight points for Michigan and a 21-point lead. Tomorrow morning, get your NFL Sunday started off on the right foot at 10 Eastern Time on ESPN. The NFL insiders give you all the latest headlines and breaking news. And then at 11, the countdown crew goes deeper inside all the storylines as only they can. It's the new NFL Sunday morning, NFL insiders and Sunday NFL countdown starting at 10 a.m. Eastern Time on ESPN. Light rain has begun to fall here at Michigan Stadium. Kenny Allen kicks off with the win. Ramel Dockery. Slicing all the way across the field, ran a long way, but made it only to the 16-yard line. Delano Hill made the tackle. Here's Cassidy.
Entertaining game between Houston and Louisville. New Houston head coach Tom Herman looking to start off his career 2-0, and this will help. Brandon Wilson, 100-yard kickoff return to tie it up at 17, but Louisville right now with a 24-20 lead in the fourth. Back to you.
That was a good hire by Houston. Tom Herman, very bright offensive mind, the offensive coordinator at Ohio State last year.
I think an underrated quarterback, Greg Ward Jr. We had a chance to see him play last year. He's something.
Storm bars Woods. Tripped up after a gain of two. Marcus McMarion, the backup quarterback, is still in. Joe Bolden made the tackle. Just the eighth play from scrimmage in the second half for Oregon State. The two-yard gain gives them three. Michigan's had the ball for more than 12 minutes, run 24 plays since halftime.
It's a big deal for them personally, Michigan, the time of possession. If they can do that, they'll win all their football games.
McMarion throws. Ricochet and almost intercepted. Desmond Morgan went diving for it.
Well, they put the bigger Clark in the ball game. Actually, Billman beats him, but the ball's late and behind. When you throw that slant, you got to be low and away.
Jeremy Clark has played more than anticipated. Jordan Lewis, we saw earlier in the game, was wobbly. He's been undergoing the concussion test, and we're told he will not return today. Oregon State's only first down of this half was on a face mask penalty. Third down and eight. We're running out of time. McMarion's pass short, might have been deflected. No chance for Storm Mars Woods.
Well, Willie Henry off the right, number 69, is going to come into your pitcher up top. He's going to be able to get in the throwing lane. Well, there he is at the three tech, excuse me, inside. But when you're on blocked, it's easy to get in the throwing lane.
Nick Perebski is the punter. Brill Peppers standing at his own 40-yard line. This punt's into the wind. He hit it low, kept it out of the breeze. And it stops dead at the 42-yard line of Michigan. 40-yard punt. Ryan Navarro, the long snapper, hustled down to down it.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy. Pacific Life, for life insurance, annuities, and investments. Choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. And Dr. Pepper. Dr. Pepper and College Football, it's a one-of-a-kind tradition.
That's a look at the Nissan Heisman House Tour display just outside Michigan Stadium. Tour will make eight more regular season stops before appearing in the postseason at the Orange Bowl and the National Championship game. That guy looked like he might rival you for a number of pull-ups in one, what do you call it, set?
Yeah, there you go. Well, we'll be testing out you, Sean, and I next week in our workout.
Rudock dumped it off in the flat. Jake Butt spun forward for a yard. Good tackle by Cyril Nolan Lewis. Talked to Kalani Sitake last night. He thinks that Nolan Lewis has a chance to be a special player.
Yeah, he's a leader. Guys look to him and made a few mistakes last week, but he's only going to get better, and he's a big hitter at that safety position.
Rudock goes under center now. Sione Homa, another one of their fullbacks. They have a deep stable of fullbacks. He ran to the 44-yard line of the Beavers, and Nolan Lewis made another tackle. It's a 13-yard gain for the senior from Salt Lake City.
And looking ahead on Michigan's schedule, the teams that they play, they're all used to defending spread-type offenses. So sometimes it's confusing for a team that's to defend an offense back from the 80s and 90s when it's power O and a fullback dive, because it's on top of you so fast that guys aren't used to getting off blocks, because we know in a read option it's usually slow to develop and defenses aren't used to seeing that.
Rudock handed it off, a flag down. Derek Green. close to the first down. And the point you make about the schedule, with UNLV, BYU, Maryland, and Northwestern the next four games before Michigan State comes here to renew that rivalry on October 17th.
Here's a matchup to watch looking at that schedule. The BYU defensive front seven against this Michigan offensive line. If you're into old-fashioned slobber knockers, tune in because you'll get one.
First and 15 from the 49. And that pass is intercepted. Monyeo stepped in front of Jake Butt and took it away. Kalani Sitake, you saw him at the beginning of that possession trying to inspire his defense to stay fully engaged, and they were, and they get the takeaway.
Well, this is on Jake Rudock because that ball has to be thrown away from the defender. Now, I think Jake Buck has to break it outside a little bit away from the defender, but that ball by no means should ever be thrown inside with a defender running to his coverage.
First interception of the season for Monyeo. And Rudock's thrown four interceptions already as a Wolverine. He threw five all of last season for the Iowa Hawkeye. We're down by three touchdowns, under 12 minutes to go. Seth Collins, the starter, back in at quarterback. Lost one, caught, and then dropped. Wow, what a hit by Jabril Peppers on Hunter Jarman.
Well, Jabril Peppers, one thing he brings is speed to the game and a little bit of pop. Now, the thing I like about this is he does not lead with his head. Watch him get his head out of the way. Avoid the targeting penalty, moves his head off to the side, and is able to target the chest where you're supposed to knock the ball loose.
Didn't go into the head or neck area of the receiver, Jarman. Spirited rush. It's a screen for Chris Brown, and he's run down by Ryan Glasgow, the nose tackle, senior from Aurora, Illinois, and the brother of the Michigan center, Graham Glasgow.
And younger brother on the team also. And running back. Yeah, all came as walk-ons. Love the Wolverines, if you're Glasgow.
Third down and 10. At the 35-yard line, Desmond Morgan, fifth-year senior from Holland, Michigan. Started the day with 239 career tackles. Played in only one game last year due to injury.
Moving. Offense number 77. That penalty's declined. Fourth down.
Sean Harlow, the left tackle. The son of Pat Harlow was an All-American at USC, an offensive tackle, and a first-round pick of the New England Patriots back in 1991, the 11th pick overall.
He's a great player. I remember playing against him. Probably took me for a ride a number of times. It's funny, all the guys I run into that played against me, they all remember how they destroyed me.
Horebsky's punt taken in by Jabril Peppers, and good coverage by the Beavers. Kendall Hill leading the coverage unit for Oregon State. Michigan ball in a 21-point lead. Here's a look at this week's Associated Press college football rankings brought to you by Capital One. Ohio State hosting Hawaii shortly, a little over half an hour from now. And how about this? We are told that Jacksonville State has just scored at Auburn. We can update that score. They've just scored a touchdown. Don't know yet about the extra point, but at the very least, it's 19-13 in favor of Jacksonville State. Derek Green weaves for a couple for Michigan. Under 11 minutes to go here. Here's Cassidy.
Yes, Sean, here's that play as upset alerts are blaring for number 6 Auburn against Jacksonville State. Troy Maine Pope, 5-yard TD run. Gamecocks up 20-13 over on the SEC Network.
Well, that'd be a bigger upset than when Appalachian State came in here and beat Michigan. Mm-hmm. Auburn's ranked number 6. That would be a bigger upset
That would be the biggest upset in college football history right there.
Wow. Here's Derrick Green. Runs for a first down. Well, I would agree with you. I mean, Appalachian State had been, you know, a very strong team in what was then Division I AA, I think. I still wish they went to Division I A and I AA, but I still can't keep track of what's FBS and FCS.
We know what the BS.
Bowl.
Yes.
Bowl, which is this. But now they have a championship at this level, championship game. So anyway, we digress. I would say, though, that Roberta Vinci yesterday beating Serena would be a bigger upset than either of those football games.
I would agree. But I just think, you know, Auburn's number six. We hear all about how tough the SEC is and how dominant they are. Well, this is an indictment not only against, it's an indictment against all the SEC. If you have a team come in that's an FCS program and beat the number six rated team in the country. Because Brett Bielema was talking about this week about Ohio State's schedule and they only have to play Michigan State, which is true. But I think Brett sometimes thinks that the SEC is so dominant that nobody else can compare.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was a lot of Big Ten bashing at this time last season when they got off to a rough start. Many of their schools in the non-conference schedule. Of course, at the end of the year, the Big Ten won a national championship with Ohio State. Derrick Green near another first down. Kyle Pecko made the tackle.
Well, if you can make it a total conference indictment on the Big Ten, then it's fair for all unbiased football observers to make an indictment on all of the SEC. If they lose to an FCS program, they're not as strong as they think they are. Then Auburn might not be as difficult to defend as everybody thinks they are. And if with that score, that tells me that Auburn does not have a quarterback. They thought they had a quarterback, and he's not playing.
Third down and one. Ty Isaac carries for the first down. And this is going to be typical Jim Harbaugh, just grind it out. Power football, trying to run out the clock. Well, it's awfully early in the season to be trying to reach judgments about which
right.
conference is better. I mean, let them play a few more games first. But you're right. I mean, the coaches are already talking, as you mentioned, Brett Bielem being one of them, about our league's better than this league and our schedules are tougher than that league. And how about playing a few games first?
Exactly. That's my whole point. I mean, everybody will make an indictment on somebody until let the season play out. And I got news for you. Coaches used to tell me this all the time, Sean. The cream will rise to the top. It always does.
Ty Isaac again. Well, you mentioned Ohio State's schedule isn't very tough, but I think the matchup against Michigan at the end of the year is going to be a little more difficult for the Buckeyes than it's been in most of their recent meetings. Bars Woods and Seth Collins trying to at least have this be an educational experience here today and what is very likely to be a loss. But you talked about talent and job one for Jim Harbaugh to improve the talent level.
And to develop that talent, which I think has been lacking here at Michigan. And they need some explosion. I mean, they have the tough running back, but they need an explosive type running back. Davion will give you everything he has, tough grinded out yards, but they need the guy that can not only go 14 to 20 yards, they need a guy that can go 80, and he'll go get it. Here's an interesting point. If I were asked to speak to the Ohio State football team in regards to the great rivalry that it is, Michigan and Ohio State, what should I tell them? I would tell them that this is a different team. This is a different guy. This is a guy that eats, breathes, and drinks football. And he's going to come down there, and he's going to have these guys playing like Michigan should play and playing like people think Michigan should play. And they're going to win a lot of ball games under his leadership.
Green, the ball carrier. The question I would ask, and definitely Michigan looks improved, even in the loss last week. You know, Graham Glasgow said after the game, I was not as upset after that loss as I was after some wins last year when I knew we just didn't play very well. But the question I would ask you and Todd, how many of these players on the Michigan starting offense today would start on Ohio State's offense?
Maybe one.
Jake Butt?
No.
Nick Van Etch is a very good tight end.
That's why I would say no. I would say Ben Braden would be my guy.
What
I see today, number 71, left guard, who's been awesome today.
Todd, what do you think?
I would say Jake Butt and Braden, but, you know, the bottom line at the end of the day is that Michigan is just, it used to be a pipeline for NFL personnel or NFL players, and now you don't see it anymore. If you go back and look at the last 10 years compared to the previous 10 years when they were winning and they were winning national championships and they were consistently winning the Big Ten, look at these numbers. First round picks, 8 compared to just 4 in the last 10 years. First round offensive skill players, 4-0 in the last 10. That's the biggest difference to me. Quarterbacks 1-4. So you're talking about every 2.5 years you're sending a quarterback into the NFL compared to just 1 in the last 10 years. And then the overall picks, it's a difference there of 11 overall players. But to me, the biggest difference really, the first round offensive skill players and the quarterbacks, that's where Michigan has kind of lost its way. And that, I think, is where Jim Harbaugh has to attack first in terms of the recruiting trail.
He's going to have trouble in this sense because all these wide receivers in high school want to go to the spread formation offenses in college that throw the ball all over the place so they can pick up numbers. My number one priority, if I'm Jim Harbaugh, I'm going after the stud explosive tailback because he's the focal point of my offense. Then I'm going to get some wide receivers and trust my coaches and my skill as the head coach of Michigan to develop these young kids and make me a balanced offense in what I want to run, which is power old school football.
Jim will not be pleased with the penalties. He's not pleased with the officiating crew, but they've had 105 yards in penalties today on 10 flags. Rudock gave it off to the fullback, Sione Homa, to the 15-yard line. Got the penalty yardage back, plus a couple. Monday Night Football back with a Week 1 doubleheader. Chip Kelly, the Philadelphia Eagles, kind of spoiled the debut of Dan Quinn as head coach of the Atlanta Falcons. And then at 10:15, Adrian Peterson back with the Vikings. Many think they have an excellent chance to make the playoffs this year. It'll be interesting to see what it's like for the 49ers in year one after Jim Harbaugh, after an 8-8 season a year ago. Coverage kicks off Monday night with Countdown presented by Applebee's at 5 Eastern Time.
Interesting fact about Dan Quinn, will wear football spikes while he's coaching a football game.
I know that. You know everything. Ty Isaac, first down, lunges inside the 5, and ridden across the boundary by Dwayne Williams, a backup cornerback, redshirt freshman from Killeen, Texas.
You know the other coach that does that?
Jim Harbaugh.
You got it.
Well, Jim would like to play. We asked Jake Rudock yesterday, said, does Coach Harbaugh still jump into the drills to show you what he said all the time? He really would still much rather play. Jim looks good. He told us yesterday he's lost about 15 pounds in the last few weeks. He said he couldn't see the film anymore. When they go to the end zone practice film, he said he stood behind the huddle and he was blocking the view of the quarterback because he was really wider than he wanted to be. Yeah.
Maybe his wife told him that. Hey, you might want to do some pushaways.
Yes. Ty Isaac carried down to the 2.
Stop eating like you're going to the chair every meal.
But he wants to go out on that field and play. There's no doubt. And he was a terrific player. All-American quarterback in the mid-80s here for Michigan.
I loved playing against him because I knew that I was getting his very best. And he was one of the most, he and Phil Simms would be the two most competitive guys that I've ever played against. I loved it because I knew I was getting his best shot.
14th play of the drive, the 13th run, and it's a touchdown for Derrick Green. Half-minute drive to go 73 yards. The extra point good by Kenny Allen. The home debut for Jim Harbaugh is going to be a rousing success.